We are now live. Go ahead.
Thank you, Crystal. Welcome to the Oregon International Port of Coos Bay Second Budget Committee meeting. Thank you all for being here today. Our Board of Commissioners, Budget Committee members, staff, and guests are all present via Zoom, and the public has been invited to watch live on YouTube channel. This meeting is being recorded. The following items of housekeeping need to be tended to before we begin. All participants are muted upon entry. To reduce background noise, please keep yourself on mute unless speaking or asking questions. You can unmute yourself by clicking on the microphone icon. For those calling in over the phone, please press star 6 to unmute yourself. To minimize distractions, staff will keep their video off when not presenting. Committee members, we ask that you keep your video on. Questions are an important part of the budget process. We ask that you please hold your questions until the end of the presentation. There will be time to ask questions then, as well as before the end of the meeting. President Kronsteiner, please call the meeting to order, and then I will take a call of the roll.
Call to order this second budget committee meeting of the Oregon International Port of Coos Bay.
Thank you, Dave. If you would, please say present when your name is called. David Kronsteiner, President.
Present.
Eric Farm, Vice President.
Present.
Bob Garcia, Secretary.
Present.
Brianna Hansen, Treasurer.
Present.
Kyle Stevens, Commissioner.
Present.
Budget Committee members, Richard Dibovic.
Present.
Nick Edwards.
Present.
Lou Liberti.
Present.
The Budget Committee Chair, Mayora Moser.
Present.
And Steve Shearer.
Present.
Legal counsel Mike Stebbins is not present today. Representing the staff today is myself, John Burns, the Chief Executive Officer. Linnell Comstock, Chief Administrative Officer.
Present.
Megan Richardson, Director of Finance and Accounting.
Present.
Brandon Calora, Harbor Master.
Present.
Margaret Barber, Director of External Affairs and Business Development.
Present.
Mike Dunning, Director of Maritime Operations and Asset Management.
Present.
Rich Lopez, General Manager, Coos Bay Rail Line.
Present.
Mary Green, Fiscal Support Technician.
Present.
Crystal Moffitt, Administrative Assistant.
Present.
And as guest, we have Dave Wright.
Present.
Rex Leach.
Present.
Ty Cutting.
Present.
And Tom Estes.
Present.
President Kronsteiner, will you please proceed with the agenda?
Thank you, John. Next item on our agenda are the public comments, and in order of as they came on, Dave Wright, would you please present?
Okay, here we go. Good afternoon, President Kronsteiner, commissioners, and budget committee members. My name is Dave Wright from Newport, Oregon. I retired 3 years ago as general manager of Banna Pacific in Charleston and Pacific Shrimp in Newport. Between both facilities, we process over 75 million pounds a year. Nick Edwards asked if I would give some thoughts and to remark on the ICE situation in Charleston. Thank you for this opportunity to speak to you, and thank you for rebuilding the ICE facility. My understanding is when the ICE facility rebuild was expedited, the cost ran away from you. I also understand Charleston has the largest ICE facility on the West Coast. But the question asked should be, is it the best? In Charleston, you have two ICE facilities. Hallmark, which uses theirs for unloading, processing, and shipping products. And when they sell it to the boats, it's sold as a tool for procurement of products and GP dollars. On the other hand, Charleston ICE is a high-cost standalone ICE facility. Here are some thoughts. have the best quality ice on the coast. Very doable. First, have the best quality. Very doable. Proper amount of salinity in the ice. Cold, thick flakes. 5% or 5 degrees or less for the ice holding bin and a good delivery system. This will bring tremendous value to the fishing community. Second, charge $80 per ton May through September to your loyal fleet as an incentive. Others, $90 per ton. Most of your ice sales to salmon, tuna, shrimpers, trawlers, and others will be during this five-month period, and the ice facility should be very efficient. Third, in September, review what worked, and you have earned the and ask, have you earned the fleet's trust on quality and price? Also, beware, inflation is here, so you will ratchet your prices over time. Potentially October through April, ice sales will slow and then raise the rates to 90 for loyal users and 100 for others. Communicate with Hallmark Fisheries. When do they shut down for their ice facility maintenance and repair so you can capitalize and be prepared for added ice sales? Once again, quality of ice. Don't price yourself out of business. And third, earn the trust of the local fishermen. Communication is the key. As many of you know, the seafood industry, due to the pandemic, is facing challenges in the market, along with a shortage of labor on the processing side. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, Dave. Rex Leach, please present.
Are we allowed to ask them a question, Dave?
Go ahead, ask them a question. We're going to have a plant discussion after this, so.
Okay, no, that's fine. I'll wait till afterwards.
Great, thank you. Rex, would you please present?
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity, everyone there. Appreciate it. I'm a lifelong fisherman since grade school, so 40 years like Nick. I got three fishing vessels in Charleston. The boat's all shrimp, brown fish, and crab. So we're here year round supporting the port in one way or another, whether I'm renting a stall or up in the shipyard, renting your dock space or buying ice. So I want to tell everyone that I'm sure Nick has that times are tough, the toughest we've seen with this pandemic, the lowest prices we fished for in decades as far as fish wise. So right now it's very hard to go outside the box and pay any more than we possibly have to for ice or for anything, groceries, fuel. We do the same thing for fuel. We shop around every time before we fuel up to find it's just put in town where we go. So I would just hope that we could keep the price down to a minimum on the ice as best you can do, and then maybe raise it over time, you know, in the next few years when things get better. So appreciate having ice plant there. We need it. I do fish for Hallmark, so I'm not there every time, but Hallmark's is famous for breaking down several times during the year, and I do have to come lean on you guys. So appreciate you being there, and I hope that you can maintain and keep a cheap price for the fleet. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments, Rex. Ty Cutting.
Yeah, hi there. Yeah, my name is Ted Cutting. I'm a fifth generation fisherman here in Charleston, and I'm representing my family's boats here, the Bernadette, the Cape Foulweather, and the Stormy Sea. The ice prices here at $91 a ton, it financially just does not make sense for us at this time. Just to support. We currently have one vessel of ours, the Stormy Sea, that's self-sufficient in making their own ice. So that's meaning they don't have to use your guys' facility maybe a couple times a year if they have a little hiccup where they'll get small amounts. And we're at with these prices, we're currently looking at making the Bernadette self-sufficient as well. Talking back to the $91 a ton, it's just not something we can support at this time. And we'd be happy to support this ice plant, just not at $91 a ton. And just the boat that I run here, the Bernadette, on average, we purchase about 320 tons of ice from you guys every year. And that's 320 tons a year that the port would be losing. If we can lower the cost down to $80, that would be more feasible for us. And that's something that we would be able to support. It's not, we understand your guys' scenario and the insurance and everything, the cost going up on that. But we got to be competitive. I mean, we're with the price difference between just up the road or even just the traveling cost, it's more efficient for us to leave. We're fishing either north or south. Well, we just won't get ice. We'll just go swinging into Brookings. And that's not what we want. We'd like to support you guys. And I hope you guys can just support us the same way. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Ty. Thank you for your comments. Tom Estes.
Yeah, good afternoon. And thanks for giving me the time to comment here. I'm out on the ocean, so hopefully you guys hear me loud and clear. I'm just going to give you
coming in fine.
I'm 30-year commercial fisherman, owner-operator of the vessel Noyo Dawn out of Fort Bragg, California. We use the Port of Coos Bay for all of our maintenance, electrical, electronics needs. All the rigging on the boat comes from Oregon Pacific and North Bend. We do all of our maintenance in Coos Bay and really appreciate the Port of Coos Bay and the support facilities you guys provide. I fish pink shrimp on the Oregon coast in the summers. We do a lot of offloading in Coos Bay and Winchester Bay this year. Winchester Bay doesn't have an ice plant, so we transit south after the offload and ice up at your facility. I appreciate your new facility that you've provided us. Got ice there last week, wonderful spot. Couple things, I echo the sentiment of the other fishermen. The ice price at $91 a ton is extremely high. Your competitors to the north and to the south are all cheaper. For me, especially this year, unloading in Winchester Bay instead of Coos Bay, just the availability on docks is the reason for that. We would probably go north for ice in Newport instead of going to Coos Bay if the trip was, to the north after the offload. As far as the ice, just wanted to let you know, the ice plant itself, very nice, beautiful state-of-the-art equipment. The ice is not up to par what you used to sell us. It's what I take per ton for every trip is roughly 20 tons. We ice the boat exactly the same every trip for the maximum carrying capacity of the boat. In Astoria, at the processing plant that I work for, that's usually around 18 to 19 tons. At your plant, it's 22 tons. I made the trip out of Coos Bay last week, and the ice didn't last. I mean, it's not as cold as the other plants. It's nice, flaky ice. It's just not cold. And we ran out of ice at a 75,000-pound trip, where the trip before was close to 100,000 pounds. And, so instead, if I was to re-ice at your plant, I would actually end up having to take probably 27 to 28 tons to ice the same amount of shrimp for the less amount at the other places. So it's not just the cost of the ice. You have to buy more ice at your plant to ice the same things. And I'm sure this is stuff that you can get worked out, on the production side too, getting it colder to last longer on the boats. When we make a trip, by the time we get in, we have, roughly a foot of top ice on top of all the shrimp when we get to the dock. When I made the trip with the Coos Bay ice, we literally had none. And for one thing, you're charging $91 for a subpar product, which I hope you guys can get straightened out. It's a very nice facility. And I really appreciate your guys' time today on this. You got to also realize I'm a transient vessel. I fish the Oregon coast up and down all summer long, but I really do like to come to to Coos Bay. Like I said, it's our second home from our home port. We do all of our maintenance there. We bring, when we come to Coos Bay, we bring a lot of problems with us that your people can fix for us, which means that we're spending money, not just with your ice plant, but with the supporting businesses that you're lucky to have in your port. And you got a good fishing fleet there. They should, you know, it's a competitive world out here right now, market-wise. The shrimp price is down worldwide. Everybody's getting a little bump this year. We didn't get it. And, you know, the margins are tight. So at $91 a ton, you're roughly about 20% higher than probably the rest of the places on the coast. And I think for your local fleet and your people that are loyal and come to your port, it'd be awesome to see an $80 a ton final price there. So thank you very much for letting me talk today, and I appreciate the hard work you've all done.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you for your comments. John, do you have a...
Dave, if I may, we have one more member of the public who would like to address the meeting, and that is Josh Whitley.
Whitley,
I'm sorry. Apologize, Josh.
Yeah, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
So very similar situation to Tom. I'm out on the ocean, so if I drop off, I apologize. I'm on the fishing vessel Miss Emily, third generation fisherman on this boat. It was actually built in Charleston at the Giddings Boatyard there in 2013. So a lot of history for this vessel in that particular port, very similar. Do all of our maintenance there, unload when we can there, bottle out ice there over time. And certainly when we heard that the $90 a ton or 91, whatever it may be now, was going to be the going rate there, it was a little bit of sticker shock. So we are a transient vessel. We're going to spend time in Coos Bay as often as we can, but very similar to some of the other sentiments you've heard, we're probably going to pass over it at that rate. This trip in particular that I'm on, I have ice from Brookings and I have ice from Newport, so I skipped in the middle. And we're probably going to have to think about that kind of thing. We have to truck our shrimp a lot of times to Astoria with the market that we're on, and you know, where we go and where we choose to do business, it all adds up between trucking and ice and offloading, all of that stuff. And to be $90 a ton when you have $75 and $50 price tags all up and down the coast as options on your way to and from is certainly hard to wrap your mind around what's going to make sense unless it's a absolute last resort. So that's my two cents. Another transient vessel that comes in and out, likes to do business in Coos Bay, enjoys my time, enjoys the people there. But certainly that's a little bit of a red asterisk next to it now. Thank you.
Thank you, Josh. Appreciate the comments. Our next item on our agenda is the discussion, and perhaps Nick or others, if you have questions at this time, would be an appropriate time.
Thanks, John. First off, I'm really happy that Josh and Tom made the effort to be on the call to give you an outside look at what the transient vessels actually bring into this community. As I said, they come in to buy our ice. They come in to buy our moorage. They utilize the shipyard. You know, I mean, they come into the community, spend money in the community from hotels and restaurants and buying their groceries. And most of it, the port gets a cut of. We want to encourage vessels to come into Charleston to buy our ice. First off, I wanted to talk with Ty. You know, as some of the budget committee members or commissioners, you're probably not familiar with the Cuttings or Ty, but Ty is a fifth generation fisherman, and you know, the Cuttings are a major contributor to Charleston's economy. They have 11 FTEs that are full-time employees. They have four properties and three fishing vessels. One of their properties, they have a full-time secretary and a full-time fabricator on site. The Cutting fleet has been a consistent supporter of Charleston Ice with the Cape Fowler, the the Bernadette and the Stormy Sea for 40 years. They bought ice. They've been loyal customers to Charleston Ice. But now, you know, as what we're seeing with the price point, Ty has just said that he has to find another competitive option. We had this discussion with Biz Oregon with Chris Cummins that fishermen are very creative. We don't have to buy ice from Charleston Ice. So Ty is probably one of the first ones with the Stormy Sea and now the Bernadette that is gonna go forward this. And I have a question for Ty. Ty, would you be more inclined if the port was to lower the price of $80 a ton? Would you be inclined not to put an onboard ice machine and support and buy ice from Charleston Ice, Ty?
No, we'd absolutely be putting it off a little bit more. It's more of a, with the shock of the price and everything, it's more of a, well, let's figure out how we're going to do this here in the next, you know, 10-month period on that. So, I mean, absolutely. If we were able to do $80 a ton, we'd for sure be putting that on hold. You know, I mean, fishing and everything's been down and our price on our product's been down. So if we could just spend our money here locally and if it is a little bit more, but it's our local port, we'll support it 100%. And that's where I would be. I would for sure be putting that off at least for a while. Absolutely.
And so I had another, you know, comment for Tom, which I'm sure Brandon and John were listening intently to, that I have heard this with the Charleston Ice Plant. I haven't heard it from my captain, but I've heard it from other people that if the ice probably needs to be a little bit colder and you need to add more salt because I don't think I know anybody that catches more shrimp than Tom Estes or Josh Whaley. And if they tell you need to do that because they land more shrimp than I do. And if that ice isn't there, you're charging a premier price at $91 a ton where the ice is actually not the quality that they would like, you know? So that's something for the port that has to figure out. And I'm sure you guys can, it's brand new. So it's just dialing everything in.
Comment, but let's hold our comments to this budget, please.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. And then, and also, Dave, I appreciate your comments of giving the port an idea about a different avenue to approach to not only save costs for the port, but also, you know, support the local vessels in the Charleston community and in the basin there. So,
Nick, one thing I didn't say is when you talk a loyal vessel, for instance, you know, when vessels come from out of a port and they do all their business at the Charleston Ice, that is a local vessel. I mean, a loyal vessel. They do business with the port. They do vessel with that. So just because they're from the outside doesn't mean that they're not a loyal vessel, and the port should recognize that. So anyway, that being said.
Thank you, Dave.
That's all for me, John, for those people that spoke.
Are there any other comments prior to John? Do we have a presentation by the board?
We do, Dave, and thank you very much. If I may first, I do want to take a moment and thank all of you for being here. You know, this is not an easy process, and it's one that takes you away from things that I'm sure you'd much rather be doing right now. But it's very, very important to all of us to make sure that, you know, the right things are being done the right way. I will encourage this group, we do have to be mindful of some statutory obligations we have, and that is first and foremost, the notion that we have got to have this budget wrapped up and present it no later than June 30th. And that may seem like, oh, there's a whole month ahead of us, but the reality of it is because of this second meeting we had and our inability to get the budget published in the World newspaper, we are going to be compelled, and commissioners, please pay attention to this when I say it, we're going to be compelled to back up our next regularly scheduled commission meeting or schedule a special commission meeting to attend to the budget, because if we get this thing wrapped up today and get it published, get it to the publisher tomorrow, we would not be able to meet on it until the 16th of June at the earliest. So again, it's my encouragement for us to continue to move the process forward. I also want to say that I certainly have paid attention to all the comments that we have gotten on the ice plant from the day it burned down, even before that. And I think everyone on the staff here at the port have also heard those comments, take them to heart, and start to ask themselves the serious question, what can we do? So we have worked very hard. We worked very hard on, I didn't have my video on, and I was just told I didn't have my video on. So we've worked very hard to try and come up with some rationale. And I think we all understand when we went back and we looked at the numbers, the reality of it is that there were some expense items that we actually did not include in our calculations, which made the production cost of a ton of ice using our 3,300 ton point of establishment that, you know, we're looking at costing about $132 a ton to make ice. And we see that, we recognize it. Whether we like it or not, we bought into the proposition when we started the process of rebuilding that ice plant and taking on that burden. On the other hand, you know, we do have the question of price. And, you know, this is not something that we came up with a number that we pulled out of the air. Nick Edwards knows this since he's talked to Biz Oregon. When we applied with the IFA to borrow $6 million, as you all being business people know, that you don't go to the banker without having some demonstrable proof that you're going to be able to return the money that you've borrowed from them. So when we did our analysis, right, wrong, or indifferent, the number that we came up with, which was satisfactory to the folks at IFA, was $91 a ton. Again, looking at that, production price, $132 a ton, a sale price of $91 a ton, that's essentially a 31% subsidy that is being created to try and make that ice price even more palatable. To drop that price to $80 a ton, which would represent approximately a 60% subsidy by the port on the production cost of that ice to sell it. So I'd like people to really kind of keep that in their mind. The reality of it is, you're all business people, and I'd ask the question, you know, how long would you be able to sustain the notion of it cost you a dollar a pound to catch fish, but the processor was only willing to pay you 90 cents a pound for the fish? How long would you stay out there fishing? And then to make matters worse, if the processor came back and said, no, how about if we pay you 75 cents a pound for fish? It makes it a very difficult decision. I don't dismiss the fact that the port is in a different position than anyone else is, because we are a public entity, because we do have other means to help support that, which we have to the degree of right now, probably about $136,000 a year, which the port is paying for the subsidy. We have gone in and we've looked at some of the suggestions made, like trying to push the sale from 3,300 tons of ice to 4,000 tons of ice. And that's great. The reality of it is, when you look at the price differential, which you'll see in a couple minutes, you know, if we can sell 40,000 tons of ice at $80 a ton, the good news is that our loss is probably pretty much equivalent to selling 3,300 tons of ice at $91 a ton. We had tried to come up with a solution that maybe if we had assurances that we could get to that 4,000 tons of ice, that, you know, we'd be in good shape. Well, I get it. Nobody wants to sit there and make that kind of decision today, that they're prepared to pay more money or less money for something that they haven't even acquired yet. So when I tried that approach, it didn't work. So we're going to try and come up with, maybe we'll make a suggestion, if that doesn't work, of maybe a different way of trying to get to that the same way. So what I've done is asked my staff, those who are as close to this issue as anyone else to discuss with you all the very nuances of what we've seen happen with this ice plant, the pricing and where we are today, and perhaps where we can get to tomorrow. So I'm going to turn it over right now to Brandon Calora.
Thanks, John. Thanks everyone for being here today as part of this meeting. Obviously we all appreciate one another's time. Considering most of us have been part of this process over the course of the last year, I will keep my remarks on the first slide, which are inclusive of the background, as short as possible. Crystal, if you could please forward this. You know, again, but just to briefly recap what happened. So on December 20th of 2019, most of us saw firsthand from the hours of 8:04 in the morning until approximately 1 p.m. that afternoon, a ice plant, which had stood here for over 50 years of service, burned to the ground, and we suffered a complete loss on that property. Over a period of 40 weeks from that day, that Friday, all the way until the plant officially opened up in September of 2020, there were weekly meetings both with internally as well as external parties, inclusive of everyone from the Board of Commissioners, the Charleston Advisory Committee, special committee meetings pertaining to the fishing fleet itself, as well as industry partners, both on the construction and the ice making production side. So to say that this project was not fully fleshed out, you know, would be a disservice. There was an extremely high number of individuals involved in this project, and you know, the greatest minds in the industry from a manufacturing perspective and engineering came together, as everyone knows, to pull off this project in a record amount of time, especially considering that it was due to the pandemic. But again, I just cannot stress from the initial first 3 to 4 months how great the volume was on the commentary relating to how important this ice plant was to this community, how important it was to the entire coast of Oregon and our transient fleet. And let alone, it's not only that, it's also to recreational users and everybody else. We are one of the only public facilities along the coast. There are others, but the majority of the facilities are related to processing. So again, there was great demand, and in record time, we were able to complete the project. Speaking on the insurance portion of it, I will turn it over to Linnell Comstock.
Thank you, Brandon. Yes, so as is noted on this slide here, and as most of you already know, our insurance has currently only reimbursed us for like-kind replacement costs of the building and the dock and for what was physically damaged by the fire. So when rebuilding the dock and building, we had significant code and ordinance and permitting and engineering requirements that had to be adhered to, which caused increased costs. But per the insurance policy, these were only reimbursed 25%, if at all. So we also had increased costs due to enhancing the ice making equipment and to better serve our fleet, which were also not reimbursed. So ultimately, insurance has reimbursed only about a third of the cost to rebuild the ice plant, or the ice building and the dock. So we've had to seek additional funding from loans. Brandon.
All right, thank you, Linnell. Just to focus on some of the benefits first and foremost, as Linnell kind of alluded to, you know, this is an ice plant for our entire community. And when we looked at rebuilding this facility for everyone in that community, we did two primary things that were all for the benefit of the fishermen, whether commercial, recreational, et cetera. And that is that we doubled our production time from 2.5 tons of ice per hour to 5 tons of ice per hour. And we increased our capacity from 115 tons on site at any given time to 158 tons of ice that are now available in this new state-of-the-art facility. I know quality of ice is something that was discussed briefly in the public comments, and that's something that I'm going to set aside for now. As everyone mentioned, that's something that is pretty easily rectifiable. However, just to give some contrast to some of the other facilities up and down the coast, I spoke with the team at Community Ice up in Newport last week, and they have a much lower price point indeed, but they have an 80-ton capacity, and the lead time, if I wanted to order 10 tons of their commercial grade flake ice, was 24 hours, whereas Charleston, there's no wait time. We can produce up to 120 tons of ice now on a daily basis, and rare will be the time at this point where there's a reservation list that is longer than the ice that we can provide to the fleet. So again, there are some drastic differences. One of the gentlemen mentioned, you know, not only quality, have the best ice possible. That should fully be a realistic objective and goal, considering that we have state-of-the-art equipment by the top ice-making manufacturer in the United States. And just to note, one example of some figures that I pulled up over the course of the past week, when it comes to traveling for ice, the average travel time, just as an example, between Charleston and Newport is approximately an 8 to 10 hour ride if you went straight out of our port and rode up the coast to Newport. So at an average burn rate of 5 gallons an hour for fuel, that would equal somewhere in the ballpark at current market fuel prices of $240 to $300 for a round trip just on fuel alone. And at the maximum capacity of an ice purchase being somewhere in the ballpark of 20 tons, at $91 per ton, you get $1,820 for your bill. And if the price was lowered to $80 a ton, you're at $1,600, which is a difference of $220 per trip. So just an example that the savings on ice by going further away to get it is actually less than the fuel bill, let alone all the money it takes to pay the crew, wear and tear on the vessel, et cetera. Again, just as one example, obviously Newport's about twice as far away as Brookings. And then one of the other major components with the Charleston ice plan, as others have mentioned, is that we don't have any quid pro quo agreements with the fishing fleet. One of the reasons that so many other ice manufacturers up and down the coast connected to the processing facilities are able to sell their ice cheaply is because they're baking it into the price that they buy the fish from those processors that's already in agreement before the seasons begin, during the negotiations, et cetera. That is not a luxury that Charleston has. We have no agreements with anyone, and the production costs that we face are very realistic, and they're not subsidized by anyone else at that matter. Again, quality of ice, with little tweaks, we should be able to get everything up to the best ice that's possible to produce at this time. We have had good feedback from other parties as well, but again, making it colder or a little saltier are both very, very easy things to achieve. So with that, I will turn it back over to Megan to talk about some projections.
So I want to talk just a little bit of where we got our 3,300 tons that we budgeted for this year. So if you look at this chart, these are the last three complete years of ice sales. So fiscal year 2017, fiscal year 2018, and fiscal year 2019. The total tons sold in 2017 were 3,815. And of those 3,815, we've identified that 3,400 of those are customers that are still in our marina. So last meeting, Nick Edwards had talked a little bit about some of the boats that had left. We've identified some of those too. So we went through customers and any customers that haven't had any billable activity this fiscal year to date, I didn't consider them as potential ICE customers. Some of them may come back, but it's unknown that they'll be here. So fiscal year 2018, we had 3,774 tons sold, and 3,119 is from the current customer base in Charleston. And then for fiscal year 2019, we sold 4,247, but that 3,335 is from our current customer base. So that's an average per fiscal year of just and just under 3,300 tons. Next slide. So part of what John had talked about earlier was the cost of making ice. And we have some variables and some fixed costs in there. And if you look at the fixed cost, which are insurance, the fire monitoring, phone, permits, and debt service, that total is $346,538. So even without all of those variable costs, we're still making ice at a loss, whether it's 1 ton or 4,000 tons. In addition, we do have those variable costs like labor and utilities and the maintenance costs that increase the more we use that facility. And those increase with every ton that we produce and distribute. If you look at what we've budgeted to make versus what we are budgeting to spend on ice, we're at a loss of $135,000, which is about $132 a ton, which we sell for $91. Next slide. I'm gonna hand it back to Brandon for this next part.
All right, thank you, Megan. So one of the suggested solutions last week was to reduce the price from $91 a ton to $80 per ton, as has been discussed pretty widely so far throughout this meeting. The main issue that was discussed last week is that to achieve similar revenue projections, we would have to sell 4,000 tons of ice versus the currently budgeted $330 tons of ice. That, as Megan alluded to two slides ago, is based on very realistic data of the customers that we currently have in Charleston. So as you can see, just briefly throughout the columns on the spreadsheet there, at the current projection for this fiscal year at our current rate, the total revenues are $300,300. And as it was pointed out earlier, by the time all those expenses are divvied up, the net result is a loss of $136,000, which John mentioned is covered by other areas within the port itself. So the second column shows that if the historical figures were to remain the same and the price was lowered to $80 per ton, that loss then goes up another $36,300 for a total loss of $172,000. However, as of the suggestion last week, should it be possible to reach 4,000 tons of ice sold in the fiscal year, you would achieve a revenue delta that is higher, but the net result is all of $295 difference, meaning that the loss that the port sustains would only be $295 difference, which, as we can see, with no guarantee of selling those 700 extra tons, and even with the lower price and higher sales, we're literally just a hair of a fraction better off than we are at our current projections. The other issue, understandably, everyone wants ice as reasonably priced as they can get it, though, is that if we don't receive the greater sales to cover those costs, where do we recover the $36,000? As an organization, we have to balance our budget. We cannot spend money that is not there or covered by a different area. Two examples are that, you know, nobody wants to see mortgage increase, but if you wanted hypothetically to obtain a $36,000 increase to cover that lack of ICE revenue, one thing would be to raise mortgage by an additional 4.8%. which I'm sure no one would be happy about. And this is on top of the already proposed 3% rate increase to cover repairs and maintenance. The 4.8 would be in addition just to cover the lost ICE revenue. So you can see there a total 7.8% to cover this potential loss. And then, you know, the second bullet point is pretty rhetorical, but everyone's aware of the state of infrastructure and ports all up and down our coast. And Charleston is no exception. We have docks that constantly are in need of repair. Everyone's aware of the infrastructure in the shipyard. So if we are to lose this revenue on ice sales, the rhetorical questions would be, are which projects do we start cutting? Do we cut more staff? We hardly have enough people to keep up all the maintenance that is required at this point in time? Do we not put pilings in where pilings are basically at the point of breaking on any given day? Do we not rehab our facilities or our buildings, which current roofs in the maintenance shop, for example, already have roofs in them, or already have holes in them, I'm sorry, and rain falls in the buildings constantly, which all of our equipment is protected in. So just kind of some rhetorical points on that, that if we were to lose, that we get made up from another area. Next slide, please, Crystal. And then just to kind of highlight some of the differences here, this sampling is the top 10 customers that the Charleston Marina Complex has for ice sold. The number one customer, this goes back to fiscal year 18-19, bought 328 and a half tons of ice, and then the 10th customer bought 90. So you can see what the revenues were that those vessels spent when it was an old plant at $75, what they would spend now at the new rate with the new plant at $91, and then at the proposed rate of the $80. So considering that the old plant is gone and history, there's really no point in focusing on that. So I would like to focus on the column furthest to the right with the $91 rate versus the $80 rate. The highest purchasing customer at 328 tons per year is paying an additional $3,613.50 per year, which breaks down into about $301 a month. Now, for customers on this scale that are multi-million dollar operations, this is a fairly small increase to have when it comes to a year's worth of ice. I do understand, obviously, that there's many, many other costs that go into commercial fishing operations, but just to single out the ice alone, that cost is approximately $3,600 for our top buying customer. When you get down to some of the customers in the back half of our top 10, it's even smaller. And just to put it all in perspective, these 10 customers make up about one third of our ice sales in the Charleston fleet. So again, as an entity, we really have to determine, is it worth giving these 10 customers potentially the break at a further loss to the port itself? And again, how do we make up that revenue if it is then lost at the ice plant? As many people have said, it's not an easy thing to get around, but it is a very stark reality that we're faced with. And for the last part of the presentation, I'm going to hand it back to Megan.
One of the second suggested solutions we had sort of played around with was offering a rebate to customers. So for customers that purchase less than 150 tons a year, they would pay the $91. Customers that bought more than 150 but less than 200 would get a discount at $85 a ton. And those that purchase more than 200 could get the $80 a ton per rate. So if you look at the 3,300 in the first column, that's as is with the $91 and that $41 loss per ton versus if we did the 3,300, the same volume, but offered that rebate program, you know, what that delta would be, which would be of a loss of about 16,000. And then if we were to achieve the 4,000 tons, even with the rebate program, we would see less of a loss, but and wouldn't have to impact the budget. But at that 3,300 ton volume, we'd still have to find $16,000 in our budget somewhere to balance it. So just also noting really quickly too, that the total expenses for the 4,000, those increase as well because of those variable costs. I'm gonna pass it back to John to make some closing remarks.
Thank you, Megan, and thank you, Brandon and Linnell as well. I do want to point out that this, you know, this last solution, it may not fly very well, but it took us back to the notion of when we thought of the take or pay agreement, which was not palatable to people. The only way that we think that we could reasonably create an assurance bank, if you will, to help us feel more secure that we can drive to that 4,000 number is to create some incentive that says if the more you buy, the more opportunity you have to save. Short of any other suggestions, except for the simple fact of let's reduce the cost. These were the only, you know, the only paths that we can see forward. It's either to take it away from somewhere else or to try and create a mechanism where we can generate a greater source of revenue. So I will turn it back over to the Budget Committee and commissioners to entertain any questions you may have as a result of the presentation.
John, I have my hand up just a little.
Oh, I see it. Hey.
Couple of questions. First of all, the loss of 36,000 is less than 0.1% of our tax revenue. And next question is, how many times over the years has this board adjusted the budget in times when things have changed from the proposed budget? Thanks. All on raise, I hope. Go ahead.
So I'll answer it as best I can. I'm going to answer the last part of your question first, Lou. And I will just say in my tenure here, it has not happened that I know of, that there's been a change in the budget, regardless of the time.
Adjustments to categories.
I'm sorry?
Adjustments to categories. In other words, you've moved some funds from a reserve fund to help you one place or another. Yeah,
that happens all the time. That happens all the time. Generally, it happens before we get to the...
Thank you.
Now, as far as the tax base is concerned, it's how much more the tax goes to it. Because again, where does the 135,000 out of the gate come from? Where does the money that we took out of staffing that we took from Charleston and put into both administration and port operations? It's the point that do we continue to take tax dollars to subsidize a handful? And to be honest with you, Lou, it's not, you're on the budget committee, I'm not, but my recommendation is that we not do that.
Okay.
Are there any more comments at this time? Because I just want to explain something. Once we put a motion on the floor, we will have discussion of the motion. So we're not done discussing yet anyway. But Nick, are you interested in speaking?
Habitually, yes. It was nice to see the presentations from Brandon and Megan and Linnell and John going through it. I guess to go back to the first thing is, we all know that because of the ice plant, Linnell explained the insurance, we had a cost overrun with the facility because of engineering, sprinkler systems, and we did it all during a pandemic, but we were about $1.5 million short, I believe, from the insurance. And then we had a cost overrun, which I don't know what that is. And we all sat in that meeting in Charleston, and some of the people aren't on the phone that I was going to ask this to, that the question was asked, because we were all very concerned that, gosh, is the price of ice going to go up? And then it was explained to us by Brandon and John that because we had good insurance, that it was going to stay the same at $75 a ton. But then the cost overrun and the inadequate insurance kicked in. So the port had to do something to secure the loan from Biz Oregon. We all get that. And so with the extra money that we needed, it's basically that from the fishing industry side that we're being asked to carry that weight and pay that extra cost. And that's the burden that we have to work with. And I really like I said, the comments of what you just did at the end, because Dave Wright just basically said the same thing. But I think that, you know, Eric also, you made a good comment last time, Eric, that providing a dashboard, you know, would be a great thing, implementing a dashboard that you could see, the commissioners could see the sales right now. But guys, right now, we should be selling twice the ice of what we're doing right now. And if you were to look at that dashboard, it wouldn't be what we want to see. I even bought ice from you guys 2 days ago. Ty Cutting is buying ice from you today. But the ice is way down because the majority of the people are in sticker shock. And they won't get on the phone and do this. I was very happy that some of the leaders in the industry stepped up and you know, and made some comments to you guys. So if we do go down to this $80 a ton, Megan just showed us that 4,000 tons is achievable. I really believe it is, because we have the largest ice plant on the West Coast with the largest storage capacity, but we also have the highest price. But, you know, when we do run out of ice, and we do every single year in Newport or in Brookings, that people will come here to get ice. We have that 158 tons as they talked about. But the traveling, like what Brandon said, Brandon, your math is off on five gallons an hour. I burn 15 gallons an hour. The Miss Emily, the Noyo Don, and the Carter John all have the same 1710 QSK Cummins electronic. We burn about 12 gallons an hour with that. And then we're also with our auxiliaries, you're about 5 to 6 gallons. So we're about 17 gallons an hour to travel. And we do that. We go up and down the whole West Coast all through the time frame. And I actually did it last year. It was $526 to drive up to Newport to get my ice and drive back to Charleston, because I wanted to see what the cost was. But moving forward, I like what I'm hearing, and I'd like to hear some more discussion.
So Nick, this is John, and I only do this because I want to make sure this is a public meeting and it's being recorded. And I just want to make sure, as I have discussed with you before, you have again characterized the fact that Brandon and I guaranteed a $75 a ton rate. Going back and listening to the tapes from that meeting, that is in fact not what was said. What was said was that we hoped that we could do that, but we did not know what we were facing, and we could not make those assurances. And I want to get that in the record, and I'm happy to have that tape recording printed and sent to people.
You could send it to me, John. I'm just everybody that I've talked to that went to that meeting, and you and I thought it was a good idea to have that meeting with Brandon. It was a great meeting, but we didn't plan on what happened after the fact. We didn't plan on the insurance, and we didn't plan on the cost overrun. But hold on, John. That's why I wanted Ty Cutting on the phone here, because Grandma Cutting that was there, she said the same thing to me today, and so did Stormy, and so did Ty. I'm just telling you that people at the meeting, no matter what you say, right? I John, you don't embellish. I that's not you. I'm just saying that the people at that meeting, that is the gist of what they got out of that meeting. And naturally, now they're all upset because it's $91 a ton. Let's get past that, okay? You and I've already talked about that.
That's fine. I'm just clarifying the record, and I want the record to be straight.
Okay, thanks, John.
This is Eric. I'll jump in with my question, and maybe Nick, I don't know if you're the right person to help me with this question, but since you're my commercial fishing expert, I'll ask you. So to help me understand the context of this increase, I think I've got a good idea of how much ice some of the bigger fishing boats are using in the course of a year. Can you help me understand what percentage of your total operating costs, or, I mean, I don't want to know what your, you know, actual costs were, but are we talking about $200,000 a year per boat, $500,000 a year per boat, $10 million a year per boat? I mean, I don't have any sense for what that operating cost is for the bigger boats. I'm not, you know, lots of smaller boats that it's probably going to be very variable, but somebody who's fishing lots of seasons.
Okay.
And I do appreciate all the other information from the other boat captains that provided information today. It was very helpful.
So I, like I said, I buy my average for 10 years and I do buy ice from Hallmark's and I do buy ice from the Port of Goose Bay, but my main go-to is the Port of Goose Bay. It always has been. And then there's been other times that I've got it from Hallmark's, but it's about $18,150 a year for ice. So I think, and I burn 242 tie with bottom fish, with a Bernadette, which I used to run, he was 320 tons a year. But, you know, here's something else, Eric, that it's a different way of thinking from the fishing side, because you want to understand this, right? Mm-hmm. That Mayora, she asked a question that was very important. How would the price of ice have an economic impact outside the Port of Goose Bay or inside the Port of Goose Bay? And as I said, I purchase 242 tons a year. And from last year, using an ice analysis that I had, Brandon said that it'd be like $200-something difference. My difference from Hallmark's to Charleston Ice was $455 for that difference in ice, right? So that's a difference of, if I was to get all of my ice from the port and not from Hallmark's, that would be an extra $11,375 on top of the $18,000. So my ice bill would go up substantially. The biggest part of that I don't know if all the commissioners understand this or the committee members, is that we have an equal sharing component, right? So the cost of ice comes off the top. The vessel, the captain, the crew, they all share in that component. So if I, this would cost my full-time employees, my FTEs, right? My captain, or well, the wages would be $4,322 per year. And say at my plant in Charleston, Bannon Pacific, you know, 10 boats are going to unload there this year. If all of those 10 boats bought the ice from you guys, that would be $43,255 in wages that would be towards the, you know, to pay a debt service for Charleston. And when Mayor asked, how would it affect the other communities? As we know, like Charleston and like Hallmark's, they just raised their price of ice to $75 a ton. They said they're not going to raise it up to 91, but they had to get closer to you guys. They don't want to ice the whole fleet. They do not. They have a broken down system. It's old equipment, but it does give you very good ice. But the big thing is, if the vessel owners all combine at the 10 boats that unload at Bannon Pacific combined, it would cost, and they bought all the ice from Charleston Ice, it would cost their businesses and the FTEs, the employees, it's $113,750 just for 10 boats. So here's the real big thing. We have 130 vessels that buy ice on the West Coast, 130. You take 130 times the 113,000, I mean, that's a significant amount of money. You're talking $13 million. So to answer Mayora's question, it does have an impact, not only in Coos Bay, but it has an impact on other ports as we move forward, because they see $91 a ton. And it's just the nature of the beast to raise costs to cut margins. So I don't know if that helps you, Eric, or not.
Well, I was really trying to get at, you know, I'm trying to understand what the percentage of the total cost of owning and operating a boat, how much ice is a percentage of that? Because what I'm going to have to help decide is, are we going to reduce the cost of ice potentially and forego other projects that are high priority, I think, for everybody? I mean, probably the first year I was on the commission, we went and looked at the work docks back there, and that's been, you know, a item that's been high on the list. It never has made the list until this year.
You and I walked those docks together.
Absolutely. Is that what's going to have to be pushed back below the line again in order to salvage ice? And so what will help me understand is, you know, if, and I know this is a hyperbole, it isn't this, but if each boat is a $12 million a year operation and we're trying to save $3,000 in ice cost to keep that ice cost down, that's kind of inconsequential. But if it's, you know, 20% of the boat cost, you know, that's more of a big deal that we're going to have to look at a lot harder. So if you can help me with either a percentage, or I can, you know, I have no basis for what it costs to own and operate a boat. I know it's a lot, but dividing $3,000, you know, that difference by what that is would be helpful to me in trying to sort this out.
I understand. Yeah. And it's all in a cost analysis, just like the ice plan. Unfortunately, my better half does the books and I'd have to get a profit and loss and pull it up on the computer. But I mean, fuel is probably 10%. Ice is probably half of that. Ice would be probably half of that. Yeah, now, as or maybe a little bit lower, probably 3.5 to 4%. But when you start taking that component, the one thing is the business side, but when no other businesses has this equal sharing component, that if you were to tell your employees or Kyle, who you represent, or Dave, your employees, that you're gonna cut the wages that you have, that it's coming out of their pocket, whether they know it or not, that they're gonna lose $2,000 and each crew member is gonna lose $1,000. They're going, what do you mean, right? But that's what we have to deal with. I can get you those numbers. I'll ask my wife to do that, but I'm pretty sure it's close to that. And as far as what we gross, you know, I mean, the vessels, gosh, you know, anywhere, if I can make, you know, $500,000 this shrimp season, I'd be doing a lot better than I have done in the last 5 years, because I haven't been able to break that mark. And with the crab season, so anywhere, I think from 600 to 1.1, you know, 1.2 over the years, I mean, what we gross, I mean, it's cyclical, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yep. Thanks for your question, Eric. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Nick.
This is Mayora. I'm not sure where, as the budget committee chair, I'm supposed to jump in, but it feels like somebody needs to sort of guide the questions. Brianna, I see your hand up and you're at the top of my screen. So would you please go next?
Sure, and just to comment on the conversation that Eric and Nick were just having, the cost structure can also be at times close, or I guess it's important to know how close you are to profitability. I'm not saying that we need to know now, but sometimes the cost structure can even exceed where in a certain industry, if the prices are low, you know, you're, I'll say in mining, sometimes you can have gross costs are very high, but you need that little sliver of profit at the end. And if any single cost goes up a couple percent, it can actually eat up your entire profit. So even if it's just a 3% increase or something at certain times in the cycle, it can be pretty painful. But yeah, my question was actually regarding how tight-knit the fishing industry is, where we could actually utilize some type of marketing share, where trying to get to that 4,000 tons, we could work together and maybe say, I mean, I don't even know if this is allowed, but if we said we're going to put in a marketing effort and work with the fishermen to try to get to that 4,000 ton mark and offer the $80 a ton, or, you know, whatever it is that we decide for ice. But then at the end of the year, or sometime near the end of the year, if we're not, I think Dave Wright had mentioned looking back at everything in September. I think that's a good idea, looking at where we're trending and seeing if we're not near the place where we should on a couple mile markers, maybe we start looking at and have some projects that are teed up for, you know, obviously we'll have to pull it from somewhere. So, you know, then it would be pulled from some of those maintenance projects, which, you know, nobody wants to do, but we could start out by a marketing effort trying to build up the tonnage, a partnership between the port and the fishermen. And then if we can't get there, then, you know, have these backup places where we could make some cuts.
Thank you, Brianna. I'm going to move on. I believe the next hand up is Rex Leach.
Thank you. Yeah, I think I'm off mute. Yes. I just wanted to say, I think that last solution has a lot of merit. I think I would rather see the more we buy, the cheaper it is. If I was a salmon boat, I probably wouldn't like that. But I think that that is a way to encourage sales and get more people there, buying more of your ice. And I'd also like to say that my fuel bill must be more than Nick's, because it's my percentage is a little higher than Nick's on my percentages. And I'd also like to say that each fishery is different on your cost. The drag fishery has the highest cost of all the fisheries. Before we untie a drag boat and even get ice, you put the observer on board, you're backward 15% right off the top. For the buyback program, the observer cost, insurance and all to cover him. So each fishery is different and has different costs associated with it. Like crabbing has bait, you know, and bait is certainly a huge expense to the crab fleet. So anyway, that's all I have. I just wanted to say that solution you posted there at the end has great merit in my eyes.
Thank you, Rex. Nick, I see your hand up.
Again, yeah. Brianna, love the comments. You're right. We have to develop a new relationship with the commercial fishing industry right now, as I see it, because everybody knows when after maybe July 16th, I believe, from the that meeting that it went to $91 a ton, that now everybody from Westport, Washington, down to Fort Bragg, California, knows that we're at $91 a ton. That's cost prohibitive. Obviously, we've heard that. But we need to rebuild that relationship and the trust with the fishing industry. We need those customers to come in here. And I talked to Margaret, basically a barber, about, you know, about their about Facebook and Instagram. I would love to be able to work with Margaret to help do something that we could put on Facebook to show. I think, John, I did this video showcasing Charleston that I made in a presentation in London, and it really showcased what Charleston has to offer, with the shipyards and the marine stores and the moorage and the fuel docks, but a beautiful pan in of that brand new sexy ice plant. That, I mean, you guys, that's an outstanding facility. You don't see anything like that anywhere on the West Coast. And a video with drone footage flying right over that of a boat taking on ice there, and then going right out to the jetties, you know, Coos Bay, Oregon, you know, we're open for business at Charleston Ice. And we've decided, you know, to partner up with the fishing industry during tough times and to help the industry. So, you know, getting that price point out, as I said at the last meeting, as soon as possible, because now is go time. We've been on strike for 55 days, and now people are going out and the shrimp industry is in full gear tilt boogie. And the minute that we can capitalize on these boats that are balking at getting ice, like myself, I mean, the better off we're all going to be.
Nick, but we can't keep building these nice new buildings. We're losing money on what we're making, right? I mean, doesn't it fundamentally come down to just it's not like we're pulling it out of the profit margin. We're losing on this, right?
I guess, John, is so I guess my comment is, Kyle, the fishing industry, we're all different, right? At the end of the day, at $91 a ton, you're going to be and thinking that you're going to sell 3,300 tons with what I know of 42 years, you're not going to make 3,300 tons. You're going to be subsidizing more. If we don't try this approach, like what Dave Wright suggested, or what Linnell and Megan said, I think that we would be subsidizing a lot more than we are right now. And if we don't try right now, Kyle, then I think that we're going to be at a bigger impasse. And fishermen will just say, no, they're going to balk coming in here, let alone the local people getting ice. Now, granted, people are going to get ice from Charleston Ice. They will, because Hallmarks can't furnish everybody, and not everybody's going to put onboard ice machines. But people are doing it right now, Kyle, and that's, I mean, they have nowhere to turn. We can't pass our cost on to anybody else. We can't pass it on to the processor. So
no, I appreciate your point. And I think, you know, you're watching the same thing with plywood right now, but unfortunately people are still buying at $80 a sheet.
Speaking of, I bought my 49 sheets last year. Sorry.
No, Nick, back to Eric's question about what percentage of this is of cost. If ice is even 4% of your cost, which I'm not sure, then that puts your annual cost about $450,000. I got to believe it's more than that. But regardless of that, you know, using very conservative figures, I just did some quick math. On your boat, it'd be $2,600 difference between the $91 and the $80 a ton rate. And that's less than a half a percent of your operating cost if you're only at $450,000 a year. And so I'm hearing you talk about this just isn't going to fly. You know, people aren't going to buy at these rates. And unless ice is a big percent, like Eric suggested, if it's a huge percent, then I think it makes that much of a difference. But doing the math, I just don't quite see that. And I kind of am with where Kyle is. Oops, got my phone. And that he said exactly what I was thinking. We're not talking about cutting our profit on this. We're talking about actually paying more out of our budget to subsidize even more than we have now. And I think to make a good business decision for the port, we have to run this as a business. And I don't believe that I would be in favor of us cutting that price when I feel the impact is really fairly minimal. I know the rest of the industries are suffering. You know, if you talk about what we have to pay, I think that your real issue, if my phone would just stop, I'd stop. the real issue would be is in the price of the fish, and that's where other businesses have to make, you know, their adjustments is what they sell their product for. And, you know, I can't see us going even further with this subsidy than where you are.
Thank you, Dave. Eric, I appreciate your patience and I see your hand up. Let's let you have a turn.
Thanks, Mayora. This is just kind of a quick comment. You know, lots of talk about subsidies and things like that. And I think I just want to make sure everybody remembers that, you know, the more the money that we're able to generate, the more we're able to do in the Charleston complex or the port at large. So, you know, if we want to keep a good ice plant and the marina to be in good shape and the docks repaired, you know, we can only subsidize to a certain point. And, you know, I kind of take some of the comp ice sales, even, you know, those facilities, if they were to go down, you know, would they be rebuilt or are they just running them until they get there? And so we've been made very purposeful in how we've been setting our prices on all the things that we do so that we have the funds necessary to maintain the infrastructure that we have. And it's challenging. It's all over water. It's all, you know, specialty equipment. It's all expensive. So I just want to make sure that we all consider that in this, that, you know, we're trying to not only just maintain what we have and live off of depreciation. And, you know, when it all falls apart, we just walk away. We're trying to keep it at a point where we can maintain this going forward. So it's hard. I mean, every business out there is in the same boat. So I just want to get that out there, and I appreciate, again, everybody's input today.
Thank you, Eric. I'm going to take a moment. Nick, I see your hand, but I'm going to take a moment to have a turn for me. The difficulty with a budget, any budget, is that we're trying to guess what's going to happen in the next 12-month window. we don't have hard, cold facts in some cases. Megan alluded to the idea that some expenses are fixed versus some being variable, and they change as the amount of productivity changes. So really what it comes down to for me in this question is, how many tons are we going to sell at 91? How many tons are we going to sell at 80? How many tons would we sell if there's a rebate program? What's the best possible solution? Because I'm with everybody else. I'd like to be able to be everything for everybody and take care of all of the things that need to be taken care of. It's a difficult thing to project. And I think we're all seeing that today in a very real situation. There is no guarantee either way, but I think that we've heard incredibly valuable feedback from the people most impacted by price of ice being sold, the fishing vessels themselves. If what they're saying holds true, then we have the risk of not even achieving the 3,300 tons under that scenario. There also is no guarantee that if the price is reduced, that we'll hit 4,000. This is a difficult conundrum. And I think at some point, we have to make our best estimate and our best guess. The port has looked at this hard and long and really given a lot of thought to it. So I think we have to give them some value as well in identifying that they're making their best guess. It just comes down to making a choice. Nick, back to you.
Mayor, very good comments, because it's really tough to decide all this. And my hand was raised because of Dave's comments that, hey, we've been on strike for 55 days because they won't pay us enough to run our businesses, right? So we tied to the boards. 85% of the fleet was tied up while we watched 15% of the fleet fish right in front of Coos Bay. And the fishermen decided that's not enough margin to give us to go fishing. So we stayed in. We finally agreed to a price structure and we actually got what we wanted to fish for last year's prices. Well, a little bit below on the larger sizes. We are not able to pass these costs on in the price of fish. It's actually shrimp, Dave. And shrimp, cocktail shrimp, we buy more ice than any other fishery as I get to, you know, with shrimp, but we're not able to pass on those costs. And if fishermen are gonna tie up over a margin like the shrimp price, I already know how they're gonna react with the price of ice. That's why I've been trying to tell John since July 16th, I said, we've got 9 months to settle this on the cost of ice, John, because $91 is not going to fly. We got 9 months to work on it. That's why I spent 9 months of my time talking to the Coastal Caucus or Biz Oregon, trying to learn all this and how I could help the fleet with the best possible scenario. And in all honesty, I'm very happy that the port came up with something that we might be able to sink our teeth into. That's all.
Thank you, Nick. I see Brianna's hand up once more, and then I'm hoping that maybe we're coming to a place where we can consider a motion and have discussion post-motion. So, Brianna?
I just wanted to make a comment because we've been talking about running this like a business, but we're a business can't just name a price. And I mean, you can't price yourself out of the market. So we have a static cost structure, which typically when you're building a business, you'll make sure your cost structure is met with a, you know, it makes sense in the market down the road that you can actually sell at a profit. And we didn't, in this case, we weren't able to do that because it's not a business. Maybe you wouldn't have actually built this the way it was built if it were to be run that way. So, I mean, we have a little bit of leeway there, but we can't necessarily use that to price ourselves out of the market. So I just wanted to make that comment that, you know, that's a really key difference between us and a typical business type setting. So.
Thank you. Dave, John, unless there's some sort of a problem with the protocol, can I move on to item number 5 and present the recommended motion and see whether or not we can get a motion for this budget? The recommended motion, I'm going to give a pause here in case I'm out of line.
Go ahead.
The recommended motion on our agenda is that we approve the proposed budget for fiscal year 2021-22 and recommend to the Board of Commissioners for adoption. Do I have a motion? Either that one or an amended motion.
So moved.
I hear a motion. Is there a second?
This is Eric, I'll second.
Okay, so I have a motion and a second. Now is the time where we should have discussion regarding that motion. Is there any discussion regarding that motion?
Yes, this is Lou, and I can't vote for a motion as passed as if we can't work with the commercial fisherman for adjusted motion of that $80 for a short period of time and go from there. That's all.
I also wonder if there might be an amended motion, but we have this motion on the floor.
Right.
And so is there any additional discussion regarding this motion?
Yes, this is Steve here. I have a couple of observations, if I may.
Sure.
The board rejection of the 3,300 tons based upon historical data. One thing that was based on was a lower price point, $75 a ton. And I wonder if that takes into consideration the increase in at $91. If it does impact the price negatively, then Nick is going to be right, and there will be lower sales in the $3,300 projection in your budget, which at the numbers that you're currently showing in your budget may not even cover your loan costs, which the Biz Oregon may not be too happy with. Then the other observation I had, too, is there's two other ones. One is that we're talking about this deal with the percentage of the operating cost of running a boat based on ice sales. Now, I'm not a fisherman, but I do have a background in agriculture, which are similar types of businesses in the sense that they're commodity-based. And the thing is, and the ice business is the ice part of it is a small fraction of the maybe a small fraction, but those small fractions do add up into large amounts of money. And then the third thing is, I think the problem that the port has right now over this whole issue is in my opinion, okay, that is, I think this ice plant was probably overbuilt for the market in Coos Bay. So those are my observations. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Are there any additional comments regarding the motion that's on the table? Nick, I see your hand up. Nick, you're on mute.
I just want to be clear what the motion is on the table because I had a phone go off and.
Okay, the motion on the table is specifically as is recommended on the agenda. Let me read it again. Approve the proposed budget for the fiscal year 2021-22 and recommend to the Board of Commissioners for adoption. That's the motion on the table.
Okay, so I'm like Lou, unless we address the Charleston ice issue, I'm not in favor of that.
Okay, well, it's not time to vote yet, but I hear you.
Okay,
Eric, I see your hand up. Did you have something to add?
Thanks, Mayora. So I believe that the second suggested solution that the port provided to provide a rebate incentive, this is going to be an optimistic assumption going on the front end. I think like the conversation earlier, budget that Mayora made, that budgets are budgets and you don't know how it's going to turn out. I would say at this point in the game, I would be for being somewhat optimistic at this point. With that said, I still want to see, you know, a regular progression on where we are with that. If we were to go that direction and if we need to make an adjustment, if the lower price point does not result in more ice, you know, we'll have to readdress that potentially or look at other projects that are, you know, how to balance that budget. But so if and when the point would come, I would be willing to recommend amending the motion to include the port's second suggested solution to provide a rebate incentive.
Okay. Is there any additional conversation regarding the motion that's on the table?
You need a second to the amendment.
Are you making a formal amendment, Eric?
I will. I'll make the I move that we amend the motion on the table to include the price structure as shown in the second suggested solution, which had a tiered ice rate for over 200 tons per year, $80 rate, 150 to 199 tons per year, $85 a ton, and less than 150 tons per year at $91.
Thank you. There's an amendment and to the motion, and I believe I heard a second.
I'll second.
Thank you. Okay, so the motion as amended is to approve the proposed budget for fiscal year 2021-22 and recommend for the board of to the Board of Commissioners for adoption amended to consider the rebate program as presented on the suggested solutions page. I'm holding it up. Where there is a rebate program going from tons greater than 150 to 200 based on volume. Did I capture that well enough? Okay. Is there any additional discussion regarding the amendment? Nick, I see your hand up. You're muted.
And I'm not even getting better at this. So question is for Megan probably. So does this go, the 200 tons, how do you get to, I mean, does it go off of last year or the previous year? How is that, how do you get to the 200 tons? So are you paying, you know, $80 a ton when we start this new program, or do you go from the past? So
it would be per fiscal year. So starting July 1st is when this budget is enacted.
Okay. So July, so it would go from July 1st to July 1st?
To July 1st to June 30th.
To June 30th.
2022.
Okay. Yeah. So what I'm wondering is to get to that 200 tons, shrimp season, we're in the middle of trying to change the starting date of the Oregon pink shrimp season to May 1st instead of April 1st. So then, you know, right now, I think we went till May 20, we've on the last 5 years, we started the fishery around the 15th of May till about the 25th of May is when we started this year. So it's we're going to lose months of fishing there, about a month and a half, I would think, to get to the target point of 200 tons.
I mean, I can't change the rate for this fiscal year.
Right.
We've already approved that budget and approved that rate.
Nick, regardless of the timing of the season, there will be a 12-month window in the fiscal year. So if it's capturing the end of this season, it'll capture the beginning of the next season. So there's always that 12-month window. When you hit that 200-ton rate is dependent upon how much usage there is and timing of the usage.
So you're saying, it's Megan, and to understand this to other people that I have to explain this to, that if I buy ice from right now from $91 a ton, right? I buy ice at $91 a ton currently, and if I buy over 200 tons, I'm going to get a rebate back?
Mm-hmm. Starting at the beginning of this fiscal year?
Yeah, from July 1st. Of 2021 to June 30th, 2022 is the rebate period. So once you reach that 200 tons in that time frame, then you would be eligible for a rebate.
Okay.
Brianna, I saw your hand up. Did you have a question or a comment? Any additional discussion?
So I have a comment, and there may be an easier way. And I'm looking at when we consider the reduced price, comparing 3,300 tons at $91 and 4,000 tons at $80, we came out with the same amount. And if we were to achieve that, this budget would stay intact. If we do it the way you're doing it, we're going to have to find another $16,000, which we don't have yet. So that means that we're going to have another meeting. So what I'm thinking, and we can withdraw amendment, make another one, but I'm just considering that we sell ice at $91 a ton. And at the end of the year, if we sold 4,000 tons, we give a rebate to everybody on a percentage of their ice. And anybody that wants to show receipts, we'd give them the rebate, the difference between $91 and $80. And if it's somewhere in between, you know, so that's $11. If it's somewhere in between, maybe we give them a rebate of $6 or $8, or even if it goes over, perhaps we could even rebate more. And that would balance this budget, and that's kind of fair across the spectrum of all of the ice purchasers. Anyway, just a thought. I'm just thinking. Thank you.
Dave, I'd make a comment that the projections that were used for the tiered event at 4,000 tons, while you're right, it doesn't cover the entire amount. Again, a lot of this is speculative, and I suspect that if this is a program that works, that the balance would be achieved at some particular point in time. And I think we can pass the budget with the amendment and still make the adjustments that are necessary within the scope of the budget, should we meet that threshold.
Thank you, John. Any additional question, comment? If not, I'll call for the vote. Okay, those in favor of the recommended motion as amended, please say aye.
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 Thank you. Any opposed?
I oppose.
I heard two opposed. Anyone abstaining?
Mayor, if I may ask, this is John. Perhaps we would be better off going down the roster and having people vote so there's no confusion as to how they voted.
How about helping me out with that, John? Can you just call out the names?
Sure, will do. Dave Kronsteiner.
Aye.
Eric Farm.
Aye.
Brianna Hansen.
Aye.
Bob Garcia.
Aye.
Kyle Stevens.
Aye.
Lou Liberti.
Opposed.
Nick Edwards.
Aye.
Steve Scheer.
Opposed.
Richard Dibovic.
Aye.
Mayora Moser.
Aye.
All votes tallied.
According to my calculation, that is 8 aye and 2 opposed. Motion passes. I want to take a moment and just thank all of you for your time and your attention and your listening carefully to all of the information that was provided, to the port and the staff for taking the time to consider everyone's thoughts and finding creative solutions that I think will be to the best interest of the community as a whole. Having said that,
I would
hand it back over.
Yeah, you've done a nice job. I appreciate that. And I appreciate the commission again stepping up and putting together a presentation and a potential, and what turned out to be a solution, and all the hard work that they've put together to present this budget. Thank you all. This meeting is adjourned.
Dave, yes. So all the commissioners know, we will send out a doodle poll as to how we proceed with the next commission meeting and the fact that we've got to do this budget hearing after the 15th.
Great. Thank you, John.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.